Random House Audiobooks presents Fierce Pajamas, an anthology of humor writing from The New Yorker. Edited by David Remnick and Henry Finder. Read for you by Patrick Frederic, Chris Gannon, Michael Goss, Julie Halston, Byron Jennings, and Faith Prince.
Spoofs.
Dusk in Fierce Pajamas by E.B. White, 1934. Ravaged by pink eye, I lay for a week scarce caring whether I lived or died. Only Wamba, my toothless old black nurse, bothered to bring me food and quinine. Then one day my strength began to return, and with it came Wamba to my bedside with a copy of Harper's Bazaar and a copy of Vogue. "I brought you a couple magazines," she said proudly, her red gums clashing. In the days that followed, happy days of renewed vigor and reawakened interest, I studied the magazines and lived in their pages the gracious lives of the characters in the ever-moving drama of society and fashion. In them I found surcease from the world's ugliness, from disarray, from all unattractive things. Through them I escaped into a world in which there was no awkwardness of gesture, no unsuitability of line, no people of no importance. It was an enriching experience. I realize now that my own life is, by contrast, an unlovely thing, with its disease, its banalities, its uncertainties, its toil, its single-breasted suits, and its wine from lesser years. I am aware of a life all around me of graciousness and beauty, in which every moment is a tiny pearl of good taste, and in which every acquaintance has the common decency to possess a good background. Lying here in these fierce pajamas, I dream of the Harper's Bazaar world, the Vogue life, dream of being a part of it. In fancy, I am in Mrs. Cecil Baker's pine panel drawing room. It is dusk. It is almost always dusk in the fashion magazines. I have on a Gantner and Matter knit jersey bathing suit with a flat striped bow and an all-white buck shoe with a floppy tongue. No, that's wrong. I am in chiffon, for it is the magic hour after bridge. Suddenly a Chippendale mahogany hors d'oeuvre table is brought in. In its original old blue and white spode compartments, there sparkle olives, celery, hard-boiled eggs, radishes, evidently put there by somebody in the employ of Mrs. Baker. Or perhaps my fancy wanders away from the drawing room. I am in Mrs. Baker's dining room, mingling unostentatiously with the other guests, my elbows resting lightly on the dark polished oak of the Jacobean table, my fingers twiddling with the early Georgian silver. Or perhaps I am not at Mrs. Baker's oak table in chiffon at all. Perhaps instead I am at Mrs. J. Gould's teakwood table in a hand-knitted Annie Blatt ensemble, in diluted tricolors and an off-the-face hat. It is dusk. I am dining with Rose Hobart at the Waldorf. We have lifted our champagne glasses. To sentiment, I say. And the haunting dusk is shattered by the clean glint of jewels by Cartier. It is dusk. I am seated on a Bruce Butfield puff, for it is dusk. Ah, magazine dreams. How dear to me now are the four evenings in the life of Mrs. Allen Ryan, Jr. I have studied them one by one, and I feel that I know them. They are perfect little crystals of being, static, precious. There is the evening when she stands motionless in a magnificent sable cape, her left arm hanging gracefully at her side. She is ready to go out to dinner. What will this, her first of four evenings, bring of romance, or even of food? Then there is the evening when she just sits on the edge of a settee from the modern age galleries, the hard, bright gleam of gold lamé topping a slim, straight, almost empire skirt. I see her there, the smoke from a cigarette rising, sitting, waiting. Or the third evening, the evening with books. Mrs. Ryan is in chiffon. The books are in Morocco. Or the fourth evening, standing with her dachshund, herself in profile, the dog in full face. So I live the lives of other people in my fancy. The life of the daughter of Lord Curzon of Kettleston, who has been visiting the Harold Talbots on Long Island. All I know of her is that she appeared one night at dinner, her beauty set off by the luster of artificial satin and the watery fire of aquamarine. It is all I know, yet it is enough. For it is her one perfect moment in time and space, and I know about it, and it is mine. It is dusk. I am with Owen Johnson over his chafing dish. It is dusk. I am with Prince Machiavelli over his vodka. Or I am with the Countess de Force V over her bridge tables. She and I have just pushed the tables against the wall and taken a big bite of gazpacho. Or I'm with the Marquis de Polignac over his pommery. How barren my actual life seems when fancy fails me here with Wamba over my quinine. Why am I not to be found at dusk, slicing black bread very thin as William Powell does to toast it and sprinkle it with salt? Why does not twilight find me as it finds Mrs. Chester Burden covering a table with salmon pink linens on which I place only white objects, even to a white salt shaker? Why don't I learn to simplify my entertaining, like the young pinchpenny in vogue who has all his friends in before the theater and simply gives them champagne cocktails, caviar, and one hot dish, then takes them to the show? Why do I never give parties after the opera as Mr. Paul Cravath does, at which I have the prettiest women in New York? Come to think of it, why don't the prettiest women in New York ever come down to my place, other than that pretty little Mrs. Fazenzi whom Wamba won't let in? Why haven't I a butler named Fish, who makes a cocktail of 3 parts gin to 1 part lime juice, honey, vermouth, and apricot brandy in equal portions, a cocktail so delicious that people like Mrs. Harrison Williams and Mrs. Goodhue Livingston seek him out to get the formula? And if I did have a butler named Fish, wouldn't I kid the pants off him? All over the world it is dusk. It is dusk at Armando's on East 55th Street. Armando has taken up his accordion. He is dreaming over the keys. A girl comes in, attracted by the accordion, which she mistakes for Cecil Beaton's camera. She is in stiff green satin, and over it she wears a silver fox cape which she can pull around her shoulders later in the evening if she gets feeling like pulling a cape around her shoulders. It is dusk on the Harold Castles Ranch in Hawaii. I have risen early to shoot a goat, which is the smart thing to do in Hawaii, and now I am walking silently through hedges of gardenias past the flaming ginger flowers, for I have just shot a goat. I have on nothing but red sandals and a Martex bath towel. It is dusk in the Laurentians. I am in ski togs. I feel warm and safe, knowing that the most dangerous pitfall for skiers is color, knowing that although a touch of brilliance against the snow is effective, too much of it is the sure sign of the amateur. It is the magic hour before cocktails. I am in the modern penthouse of Monsieur Charles de Bistiguie. The staircase is entirely of cement, spreading at the hemline and trimmed with padded satin tubing caught at the neck with a bar of milk chocolate. It is dusk in Chicago. I am standing beside Mrs. Howard Lynn, formerly Consuelo Vanderbilt, formerly Sophie M. Gay, formerly Ellen Glendinning, formerly Saks Fifth Avenue. It is dusk. A pheasant has Julian Street down and is pouring a magnificent old red burgundy down his neck. Dreams, I'm afraid. It is really dusk in my own apartment. I'm down on my knees in front of an air-bound radiator, trying to fix it by sticking pins in the vent. Dusk in these fierce pajamas. Kneeling here, I can't help wondering where Nancy Wheel is in her blue wool pants and reefer and her bright red mittens. For it is dusk. I said dusk, Wamba. Bring the quinine.
Save My Seat by Mike Nichols. 1961. There is a still newer wave of films on its way from Italy. Here are some synopses so that you can plan your weekends. The Occurrence. Giovanna has lost her thimble. For the first 2 3/4 hours of the film, she and her friends look for it. In the final 10 minutes, she is raped, and we are left with a sense of loss. The Occurrence is the first film made by the cruel and talented Dominic Fabiani.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.